Simon & Schuster Audio presents Daughter of Mine, a novel by Megan Miranda. Read by Inés del Castillo.
Prologue. The drought started in the west. We watched on the news as the waters dropped in the reservoirs and lakes, and their secrets and ghosts slowly emerged. The Great Salt Lake was suddenly in danger of disappearing, threatening to release a toxic dust hidden at the bottom. Skeletons surfaced from the edges of a shrinking Lake Mead. In barrels and boats, bare bones scattered on a dried-out shoreline. Missing persons, finally found. Unknown crimes, suddenly uncovered. We watched from the safety of our enclave on the East Coast, where freshwater rivers cut down the mountain, sustaining our lake, our community. We watched from our living room couches, with lush forests of trees right outside the windows, the promise of the green North Carolina landscape. We thought ourselves protected, immune. It came here on a delay, like everything else. The latest fashions, high-speed internet. And then slowly, the rotted wood beneath the docks became visible, soft and black. Boats were raised up into dockhouses or anchored farther out where they drifted back and forth like ghost ships in the night. We were told not to water the grass, not to launch a boat onto the lake from Gemma's Creek, not to worry. Even as more things slowly started appearing, branches and trunks reaching out from the surface, sunken beer bottles wedged into the newly exposed mud. In the west, there were the bodies. But here we were less flashy, less prone to drama and sensation. We preferred our crimes quiet, our cases closed. That was my father's motto. He was the last of a dying breed, I thought. A detective who got no shot of adrenaline from either the chase or the justice. So very different from the craving of my youth. Give me a wrong so that I may punish. So when the drought finally arrived, I supposed it was fitting that the first thing to attract attention was not a body or a barrel or a bone. It was something quieter. Something we didn't understand at first. Quieter. But no less dangerous. Part 1. Father. Chapter 1. 62 days without rain. Wednesday, May 15th, 5:30 p.m. Precipitation, zero. They raised the car from the lake on the same day as my father's memorial. Two unrelated but equally newsworthy events. Something lost, something found. My father had been gone for over 3 weeks, and in the days since, I'd found myself measuring time differently. A recalibration, a new reality. I listened to the weather reports each morning on the radio in Charlotte. 62 days without rain, and thought instead, 23 days without him. It seemed like half the town had come out for the celebration of life, crowding the deck of his favorite restaurant, raising a glass, or two, or three, to the portrait of Detective Perry Holt, while the other half was gathered around an inlet on the opposite side of Mirror Lake, watching as the salvage company hooked a crane to the car that had been spotted below the surface a few days earlier. All I could think was, of course this is happening now. I'd always suspected that my father alone had held things together by sheer force of will, not only in our family, but in the entire town. And without his careful gaze, his steady oversight, everything had shifted off kilter. Even for this, he had left us his guidance. A cremation instead of a burial. A party instead of a funeral. Food covered by the department. drinks on him. But the discovery of the car was big news in a small town, and no one had seemed sure what to do. With the outside world watching, it had made headlines all the way in Charlotte, even. The water level of Mirror Lake had dropped to the lowest it had been in decades, and a fisherman had practically run up on top of the sunken vehicle. There was no evidence of a crash. No bent metal or crushed vegetation at the curve of road above the inlet. So the rumor spreading through the crowd was that the old rusted sedan must have been there for years, before the addition of the new guardrail. Apparently, a dive crew had been out to inspect the car the day it was found, but saw nothing inside. And yet, it had the air of something I couldn't quite put my finger on. A sign of things emerging, changing. A warning that things were beginning here, too. There was something in the air, keeping everyone on edge. A buzzing of insects in the muddy puddles beneath the deck. The setting sun glaring sharply off the surface of the water, so we had to squint just to look at one another. Leaves, dry and brittle and churned up in the wind, falling to earth at the wrong time of year. This wasn't how things were supposed to go. There were supposed to be stories on the mic set up beside the bar for anyone who felt moved to speak. We were supposed to find solace in the liquor and the laughter, a release, an acceptance. Perry Holt was gone too soon, and it wasn't fair. But my God, what a life he had lived. So many people here attributed their lives to him. Whether he'd pulled them out of danger or pushed them toward the help he knew they needed, today we were supposed to remember it all. But now news of the car was splitting everyone's attention and sense of responsibility and propriety. For every comment of, "he was such a good man, a good leader, a good role model," booming from the sound system, there was a quieter whisper carried in the crowd around me. "It's coming up. No license plate, no VIN. Stolen and dumped, probably." While the youngest Murphy girl, now a few years out of high school, told the story of how my father found her drifting in the middle of the lake as a kid, her tube cut loose from the dock, I heard the group to my side taking bets on what they'd find inside the trunk. A body, stolen goods, a gun. I turned to stare, hoping to shame them into silence. But they were looking toward the entrance instead, where a group of uniformed officers had gathered in the doorway. It didn't help that a lot of the people here were presently or formerly connected to law enforcement, either by profession or family ties, or that men and women in uniform kept rotating in, alternating between paying their respects and relaying updates to my brothers, both of whom had suddenly disappeared again. I didn't blame them. I was pretty sure I'd find them on the long sliver of deck at the side of the building, the only reprieve from the crowd. I saw Caden first, pacing back and forth, all frenetic energy. He paused periodically to hold his phone out over the water, trying to catch a signal. Any other day, he'd be out there himself. He'd been the very first on scene. The call about the car came in while he was working his normal shift on lake patrol. Gage, meanwhile, remained perfectly still, arms resting on the wooden railing as he stared out at the water. From a distance, he looked so much like our father, it stopped my heart. Sharp nose, prominent jaw, dark cropped hair. Heavy slanted eyebrows that gave everything he said an air of gravity. I slid up beside him, mirroring his posture. How many years had I mimicked him, idolized him, revered him as the hero of my youth? He let me follow him around far longer than most older brothers might, and I relished his praise. "Hazel can climb that tree," and "Hazel will jump from that bridge," and "Hazel can beat you in a race." All I'd had to do was show up and prove him right. Now I tried to mirror not only his position, but his emotions. Find the balance. Rise to the moment. Like our father, Gage was always the responsible one. And now he found himself in a new role, not only in the department, but in our family. Maybe that was the curse of being the oldest. Are we hiding out? I asked, as Caden's footsteps retreated down the deck. Gage tilted his head to the side, squinting.
We're hiding out.
Then I could feel Caden's footsteps getting closer again, a metronome keeping time. He stopped pacing behind us.
Mel's trying to send pictures. They're not coming through.
I could see the pent-up energy in his stance, though his expression remained calm, controlled. The things he could hide under his cherub-shaped face, even at 27.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.